Welcome to Webinar Wednesday. We are excited you are with us. Today, Thomas Finn of Medigate will moderate this 60-minute webinar featuring experts Karen McMillen, security analyst, and Rosalind Rucker, biomedical cybersecurity specialist, both of Asante. We do want to thank our sponsor, Medigate. Medigate is the industry's first and leading dedicated medical device security and asset management platform, enabling providers to deliver secure, connected care. Medigate fuses the knowledge and understanding of medical workflow and device identity and protocols with the reality of today's cybersecurity threats. With Medigate, hospital networks can safely operate all medical devices on their network, enabling deployment of existing and new devices to patients while ensuring privacy and safety. For more information, please visit www.medigate.io. Let's give one lucky attendee the opportunity to win a Webinar Wednesday webinar t-shirt by telling us what city and state are home to the Medigate headquarters. You can answer now by using the questions feature on your webinar dashboard. A couple of reminders before we get started. Our next HTM mixer will be October 1st and 2nd at the Hyatt Regency in Milwaukee, Wisconsin. You can learn more by visiting htmmixer.com. We are also hosting the MD Expo in Tampa, Florida this November. Registration is open on mdexposhow.com. All right, today's webinar is eligible for one CE credit from the ACI. You can obtain your CE certificate by completing the post-webinar survey. For more details on this at the end of today's webinar. As I mentioned earlier, our speakers today are Thomas Finn of Medigate, Karen McMillen, security analyst of Asante, and Rosalind Rucker, biomedical cybersecurity specialist, also of Asante. Thomas, you may begin whenever you are ready.
Well, thanks so much and welcome everyone. As the title slide here indicates, we're going to be discussing the benefits of an integrated approach to asset management and cybersecurity, and not only why a common data foundation, which makes sense here, a single sheet of music is critical to enabling effective coordination, but as our guests Karen and Rosalind reminded me when we discussed the topic today, that cross-departmental leadership must be appropriately educated, otherwise none of this can happen. More specifically, if a strategically considered, realistically phased, programmatic approach is our goal, there is no way it's going to receive the support it requires without it. So when we get to the Q&A portion of the webinar, I'm going to encourage your questions on this point, as Karen and Rosalind have been very effective in this regard at Asante, and I think it's notable. Instead of rattling through these statistics around the threat, as I think they kind of speak for themselves at this stage of the game, allow me to remind everyone that healthcare presents the cyber criminal with the most vulnerable and lucrative attack surface across industry. No other vertical comes close. Healthcare is hit at a rate roughly four times greater than any other industry segment, and its bounty for the criminal is nearly 100 times richer. 68% of health systems self-report that they have been hit at least once over the last 2 years. That's a self-reported number. And on the patient safety front, while the doomsday scenario that we know about, where the bad actor gets remote control of a device connected to a patient, is real, it's nothing that we need to dwell on, because the truth is any successful breach of an enterprise network, especially in healthcare, is ridiculously costly, both financial and reputational. And because the disruption caused by a successful breach invariably ripples through the system to negative impacts on staff and patients, that's why all the regulating authority is on top of this. whether it's the FDA and its evolving guidance, or the Joint Commission and its directives. Of course, there's HIPAA, emerging security risk assessment frameworks from entities like NIST, recommendations from professional organizations like AMI, industry data stewards like, for example, ECRI. It doesn't matter. They have all converged around the same common sense requirement, and that is that health systems have got to establish and maintain an accurate inventory of their connected assets and do something demonstrable to credibly secure them. So to level set here, Asante's Medical Device Cybersecurity Program, you'll hear the acronym MDCP repeated, it's very much in its early phases. So as you listen to Karen and Rosalind here today, please know that they'll be the first to tell you that they expect their current roadmap will change and that they haven't yet executed on some of the capability that will be discussed here today. But they clearly thought through the use cases. They understand the integrations required throughout their ecosystem to make all of this work. And they know, like most of us, that while a lot of what will be covered today is considered bleeding edge, it really isn't pie in the sky. It's right in front of them, given the quality of visibility they are now achieving. Asante's MDCP is committed to comprehensive coverage of all IoT. So with that in mind, even more than having a detailed understanding of their current medical device inventory, meaning fully profiled, granular, actionable device profiles, they also need to understand what these devices require in terms of workflow or to accomplish their respective missions. For example, what a compliant workflow actually looks like. They've got to have this in context before they can effectively prioritize their remediation activities, which is the big chunk of the MDCP's initial phase. So with that, Karen and Roz, why not get us started by explaining how you looked at the roles and responsibilities by workflow across departments as a way to get peers and leadership initially engaged, and how you used the visibility that you were achieving to educate leadership.
Thanks, Tom. I'll take this if that's all right. This slide here is a lot to look at. It's a lot to take in, but this gives you a good idea of what biomed and security teams are up against when they want to go ahead and improve the security standing of their devices. This slide is helpful because this is what management needs to know. That on the left-hand side, you have four major functionality, if you will, that you need to secure your devices: asset management, cyber hygiene, detection response, and policy enforcement. We have clinical there because they're pointing out we're talking about medical devices now, although other IoT also has these requirements. On the right-hand side, you can see all the different organizations that need to, or work teams that need to come together to provide security to these devices. On the left-hand side, you see the information security team. Now, we have a lot of different roles listed here, a lot of different responsibilities, but depending on your company, one person or one security engineer, for example, might handle everything from the SOC or vulnerability management, or it might be separated out. But we want to make it clear to management that there's all these different roles that are involved. And to the right, you can see outside of IT and outside of clinical engineering, you might have a networking team as well involved, or the application specific team. So there's a lot going on at once, and you kind of need to lay out the map. I mean, this is a pretty little grid, but we all know that some of these stars will also bleed into each other as we work together. But this is an idea, and sets the stage, if you will, for what's required. The next slide. Now, this is my favorite. This is my favorite dashboard view of Medigate. It's really pretty incredible. It's an overarching view of the enterprise biomed IoT system, and it was really invaluable to me because, you know, how else are you going to communicate the breadth and depth of the modern day biomedical device network without scaring someone or having their eyes glaze over, right? But what's the old saying? You know, management rewards measurement. And here it is in a neat, clean package, which you can drill down to demonstrate how the numbers are actually derived. My CIO saw this dashboard, and he's an ex-MD. And as is typical of the quick and curious mind of leaders, it prompted a whole lot of questions from him. It opened his eyes to what is out there as far as is one medical device and security teams of many. It was helpful in helping him understand this piece of his digital responsibility. Like, you know, when he saw this, he said, why do I have 1,247 devices sitting idle offline? There's cost considerations. I don't recognize those network protocols. Here's the complexity of the biomed world you can discuss. I didn't realize that the vendor has such a big piece of our business. He can look at manufacturer distribution with contract implications. It just helped me identify the footprint of our vendors, and which is helpful for contract leverage. He might say, what about these items of high risk? As a physician, he sees high risk on things like infusion pumps. It really got his attention. So it was a very helpful dashboard to get this conversation started. We had a proof of concept with Medigate, and I was able to show him this, and immediately helped us build a foundation for his support for our program. And the clincher was switching the dashboard mode from biomed devices to other IT, itemization of surveillance, cameras, audiovisual systems, building automation systems, which are also under the CIO purview. So he is definitely interested in using this tool for both aspects. Segue, if I want to segue over to Rosalind, maybe Rosalind, you might want to be able to speak a little bit how you're using this dashboard.
Yes, yeah, I would. I'm going to back up a little bit though and just talk about how, from Biomed's perspective, how we came to this. Our Biomed supervisor and manager recognized the need to have IT security Biomed position. One that would work alongside our IT security team. First thing we did was create a medical device cybersecurity program. Amy has a medical device cybersecurity playbook that we have followed for our guidelines while catering it to our organization. Since this was just the beginning, we decided to focus on the first two most important things, which was roles and responsibility and then inventory. Karen, the IT security side, does risk assessments, compliance, education, and more. Biomed implements the requirements that the security requirements that was on the security assessment, for example, port blockers, password defaults, patches, antivirus, et cetera. We monitor, mitigate for vulnerabilities, patch management and inventory. In this process, we found the common tool, which we both can use, so we can see the same page. The Medigate dashboard, if we drill it down to the exact device that we want to see, the most important parts of the dashboard for me were the device information, the IP address, MAC address, network connection type, VLAN, IP assignment, AP name, AP location, and last seen where the device was, and PHI. Later on, we plan on using the utilization charts for procurement and our AEM program. This dashboard has been a huge part of working with IT security to secure our medical devices. A couple weeks ago, we had a device that was on the network from one of our contract hospitals, and I was asked to see if I could find it somewhere in our hospital, and they had the MAC address, so I was able to go onto this, the search queue in Medigate and look up for the IP address, which I found and was able to get our integration group to find the AP where it was, and we were able to secure that device. I don't know if that answered Karen.
That's really helpful. I think that with the current tools you have, Rosalind, if I'm not mistaken, do not list your devices by IP address, because previously when things weren't as networked, it wasn't as important. But right now, location is critical. And so I know that that's one aspect of the left-hand side of the screen. This is actually a composite screen. It's all this information is in Medigate. You can develop your own dashboard, but this is some of the key areas that we use. If I could butt in here, I want to point out that some of my jobs, my primary responsibility at Asante is documenting security risk assessments for medical devices and about anything else or anything that has an IP address or stores data. So a large percentage of my 100 to 200 assessments each year are biomed devices. So I use in the middle there, you can see a risk score device vulnerability information. So with this tool, I can see what's out there already from a vendor, or if I have a planned replacement item for assessment, the security status and communications habit of what's out there now, I can take a look at. And we'll talk more about that in the coming slide. But I want to point out in this slide too, at the bottom, the communication map. It's kind of an endless fascination to me. It shows you where each device is communicating by protocol and destination point. This one's a little dull since there's only a handful of protocols and connections going on. So the colors and little byways are limited. But some of the devices that have tentacles going everywhere with multiple different color protocols, I've considered blowing up for wall art. I mean, they look really cool, but they're really helpful too. But anyway, seriously, I look at these a lot and learn about a network and how they're configured. You know, what's going on? What connects to what? You normally can't get that kind of view. So when I find things I don't recognize, I pull in the biomed team or even the clinical users of the device, or my white hat hackers on my team, and they let me know whether I need to be concerned or not, or investigate some of these connections that are set up or happening right now. So maybe next slide.
Yeah, I would just add, Karen, and Ross, that I have seen in POVs early stage proofs of value where we install, and you're right, this is a boring communication map, but to your point about wall art, these things can look like spaghetti a lot of times, and they're frightening because there's all sorts of unauthorized, unnecessary communications being exposed.
Yeah, like why is that device talking out on the internet, you know? Yikes. So it's always good to take a look at that. So, you know, my job as a security risk analyst, of course, is clinical cyber hygiene. And it's really challenging with these devices because, you know, they're often black boxes. They're, you know, proprietary operating systems, and traditionally manufacturers have not considered security. So, you know, this is another one of those circles. And anyone who has any involvement with the information security world knows all about these little colored circles that go round and round, since security is always an ongoing cyclical process. So you need to have a methodology, be it a NIST common security framework or risk assessment process. It's a circle wheel of methodology. So this slide indicates how I've used the tool to move through the security circle from dark to light. You know, cyber hygiene is really the ability to discover, assess, and manage the security risk that medical, clinical, or other unmanaged connected device introduces to the clinical network. So to properly assess risk, you got to have some kind of inventory data, got to know what you have if you're going to secure it, what device, what OS, what applications, what connectivity. You have to have a methodology. I correlate what vulnerabilities are found on which systems, and there can be a lot of those vulnerabilities if you look at multiple aspects of the device. So right now I'm looking by vendor fleet, you know, macro vulnerabilities to micro. The turnover is faster these days of medical devices, so the opportunity to fix things also or replace instead of fix helps as well. Then I assess, and this is a thinking problem or the thinking part, the old security formula of weighing multiple factors about the device vulnerabilities and its criticality to patients, where it sits on the network. Is it sitting on a segmented VLAN with a good DACL or access control list? How is it configured? All these different things, types of things I have to take into consideration. And with a tool like Medigate, I'm able to actually take screenshots of the Medigate risk scores and communication channels to include in my risk assessment evidence. It's really effective to help business clients that are in charge of the machine understand about security, understand what I'm doing, why I'm doing, and why. And it's really nice to have something to point to that clinicians and management can begin to understand as I perform the assessment. So here I want to talk quickly about this risk inventory. It's really great because this is the type of thing that can tell me much detail. For example, if you look under the device vulnerability, you've got a Windows 7 unsupported operating system, outdated firmware. Does it have installed AV? No. Something that I found very helpful is the VLAN topology. I can actually show someone that it's sitting on a mixed medical and non-medical VLAN, which is concerning. So by having this proof in this quick reference about what the machine is doing security-wise, it's wonderful. There's also a risk simulator. You can have a score, and it's based upon a dynamic multifactorial risk score. It includes an internal and external network connection types. All these different components come up with a score. So if you're also a security analyst, you can also obtain the MDS-2. For those of you who know what that is, the manufacturer's disclosure statement, medical device security. It shows what a medical device, according to the manufacturer, can do in terms of security. You can pull that automatically up on this tool, which is really nice because those of you who do my job know that it can take weeks for a vendor contact to get that to you. You can also submit one if Medigate for some reason doesn't have one, which hasn't come across yet. But it's a wonderful tool, and it's been invaluable for my work. So I will maybe make a segue to talk about the last slide. It said that there was a mixed VLAN between medical and non-medical devices. So you can talk a little bit about how this machine, how the Medigate uses policy enforcement to start moving towards a roadmap of better segmenting different networks. It's a key phase of our medical device program is improving network segmentation in our current environment.
Yeah, Karen, I'll go ahead and expand. I'll go back to the, I love the reference to the, they call these communication maps Sankey diagrams, but I think I'm going to start referring to them as wall art. what they're representative of in a bigger picture is, you know, we've talked a great deal about visibility, and you got to get your head wrapped around a broader definition of it. So it's not just the full attribution of the device, but it's understanding its workflows, as we mentioned. And in this context, we're talking specifically about what the device requires in terms of internal and external connections in order to perform its function appropriately. So, you know, we can look at all of this information can be compiled and has been compiled to essentially create a policy wizard or a way to automatically create, deliver security policy recommendations and profiles to the enforcement mechanisms, you know, network access control or firewalls. So, you know, as Karen mentioned, cleaning up or looking at VLAN hygiene in contemplation of beginning more effective segmentation efforts, you know, beyond port level controls, role-based controls, device-specific controls, and now group level controls. Whereas in the past, I think we've looked at that as kind of a natural evolution, finally unstalling these massive projects. The fact is that all of those methods are complementary and can be used in concert. And what Medigate has done, as I mentioned, is they've compiled all of the device and group profiles and their operating requirements and created a policy wizard, which essentially is an expert system for automatically generating those policies. So whether it's a DACL, as is for a specific device, which is the example used here, or rule sets for firewalls, they're all passed to the market's leading enforcement mechanisms, effectively closing the security policy enforcement loop. So the integrations that we have, and I throw up this slide because, you know, the point is they're all here, whether we're talking NAC or, you know, ClearPass, ForeScout, Fortinet is mentioned here, Cisco ICE, firewalls, east-west firewalling strategies that are being executed in concert with network access control. The point is that these integrations of device profiles and security policy are enabling these massive projects to the tune of cutting their implementation times by more than half. It's hard to imagine how they did it without this kind of information previously. And based on what I've learned over the last several years, I'm not sure that they did. If we think in terms of additional integrations, I'm going to let Karen speak to something that's near and dear to Asante, which is driving towards a clinical SOC, which leverages the integration of that same data I just mentioned to SIM, like a Splunk. In fact, Karen, you want to speak to that, and then maybe pause to express what we're doing with CMMS, and we'll take it from there.
Sure. I'll take it as far as Splunk and also ServiceNow. One at a time. Now, Splunk right now, we are, you know, it's a tool where you receive feeds from multiple systems to see what's happening on your network from a number of different views. If we're able to add Medigate, which already has the information in there for us, but if we're able to add, and which we will be, to Splunk, we'll get a larger contextual view of what's happening on our network. We can see that east-west, if you will, communications traffic, for alerting and being able to have the right people alert, see it at the right time. Right now, currently, because we're early in this program process, Rosalind and I both are looking at alerts, both working through them, and I always engage my white hat hackers to perform more support whenever needed. But when we get it into Splunk, it'll be able to make that whole process much faster and more contextualized. The other piece of integration that I'm excited about is ServiceNow, which is, you know, workflow tool. Right now, our IT department uses it, except for the Biomed team. Now, the Biomed team does sit under the CIO, luckily, and some organizations it doesn't, but they have their own system right now. I think it's a web TMA that they use for ticketing, et cetera. So Medigate offers us the bridge to have an internal workflow engine. I can send, make notes on alerts and write what's happened, and Rosalind can see what's going on. But if we have integration with ServiceNow, I can send work items to Rosalind or to other work teams to investigate or remediate any systems found. It kind of be under the same metrics that the IT leadership will see for all of IT. And so there's no separation between the two. It'll be a lot neater. And then I know that Rosalind is working right now to obtain a new CMMS tool and how that might integrate with Medigate. Maybe she can speak to a bit.
Yes, we are currently using WebTMA for our CMMS. It's very time consuming. It's not automated at all. So we found the need to start looking for a new CMMS. We need it to be integrated with Medigate and our med tester. We are looking at ones that are able to incorporate cybersecurity into it, store the MDS2s with the device record, keep track of recalls, device utilization for our AEM program. Medigate is going to be part of that. It needs to work alongside the CMMS that we're looking at.
Yeah, it's a, I would say that CMMS is probably the first integration on, you know, we've discussed a longer list here, but it's very, very typically the first integration that we're involved in. We're also integrated with most of the market leaders. The value prop here is pretty straightforward. CMMS has traditionally been a rather static, manually propagated platform. Some of the newer systems, not so much, but they lack a lot of information. And so what Medigate is doing through integration, as it is on a near real-time basis, continuously refreshing the inventory and any and all changes that have occurred, it is not only turning CMMS into a dynamic system of record, but it is filling in lots of blanks. Serial numbers and location metrics come to mind, for example, and how just those two data elements are facilitating recall management, something pretty simple, but something that has been very difficult historically when you didn't have that information available. And, you know, something that's notable here as well, I think, is that if Karen and Roz weren't talking, serial number wouldn't necessarily be on her short list of attributes to make sure were captured, whereas it would be at the top of Roz's list. And now they're both, again, seeing the same information and able to collaborate effectively. Collaborate is an overused term. The point is they're seeing the same information. It's being dynamically updated, not just here in CMMS, but in ServiceNow, in the form of updated policy based on changes to the risk profile of the landscape in different groups. All of this information updates and is synchronized on a continuous basis. You would think that we would have been there by now, but we haven't. You know, the workflows have been separate. The tools have been different. The data not only hasn't been available, but it certainly hasn't been shared. And that's all being fixed, which is why a long-term program like the MDCP at Asante is going to move a lot more rapidly. I'll just add in closing that, you know, the value of a common data foundation, provided it is of high quality and has appropriate data fidelity, is certainly what makes all of this happen. But as a cautionary note, when evaluating systems, be sure to investigate the quality or the veracity of any such integration claims. Although we can say that the cloud has surely eased traditional data integration challenges for everyone, including software vendors, there's a big difference between a data exchange via APIs or an interface where perhaps some shared tagging has been enabled versus a meaningful integration that has been engineered specifically to solve a business problem. Obviously, you should be looking for operationalized evidence of the latter, because when it works on a meaningful level, it works quickly, intuitively, and things come together a lot more quickly with lots less frustration, to say the least. So with that, I'm going to turn it back to Tech Nation and let's take some questions.
Thank you so much for a fantastic presentation. Let's start with some of our questions. As a reminder to our audience, if you do have a question, please use the question feature on your GoToWebinar dashboard. Our first question is for Rosalind. Although you mentioned you're early in your CMMS evaluation process, can you share some selection criteria that you think is notable based on what you knew before and after Medigate? Did anything change?
Yes. Some of the criteria that we needed was just the automated features of what a CMMS would do compared to what our web TMA CMMS does. I'm part of the AEM program also. We're trying to get devices off our PM lists, and I forgot the question. I'm so sorry. I'm really nervous right now. My brain just went
dead. Hey, Rosalind, we were talking about selection criteria, and as you were you're mentioning, you've got a pretty straightforward comparison that you can make to your existing capability, which sounds rather limited, but you brought something up there that I thought was pretty interesting around getting things off your PM list. You know, one of the things that's interesting in terms of the utilization data captured by Medigate is that it allows across an awful lot of protocols that are rich with that information that we capture to start looking at preventive maintenance on the basis of usage as opposed to time. As that thought process threaded into your thinking?
Yes, absolutely.
Next question.
All right, our next question is for Karen. Would you please share any anecdotes or additional tips on how best to communicate with your leadership? Any additional learnings that you can share on your education process?
Sure. Actually, there's a lot to the story that wasn't brought out here because there's a lot of things to show you on Medigate that take some time, but it was just kind of a long process, but Medigate really moved it into high gear. How my program, or how our program, it's not mine, it's you know, I initially drove it, but it requires multiple organizations. But once I started doing risk assessments, which is my job, and I started seeing medical devices with Windows operating systems that were quite vulnerable on a network, I performed a risk assessment on a particular device, and I pointed out the concern I had. My manager took note, and I put together a larger risk assessment that showed that, or documented that, we had more medical devices that had this type of vulnerability. However, because I didn't have Medigate, I didn't really have anything to actually itemize and in real time demonstrate where we were on patching or other vulnerabilities, I wasn't really able to make a good case. So I conferred with my manager, and he suggested that we continue to look or see if there's any automated tools out there to help with that. So we did look at a couple other vendors, in fact, three in total, that perform the same type of capabilities as Medigate. The first two were dismissed by my rather talented security team as not having the technical capability, and the team didn't have the technical acumen to answer their questions about how this was going to work and how the actual tool worked, the algorithms, et cetera. So we were unable to do that. So I was kind of hit a brick wall. So at that point, I was able to get enough information from those vendors to obtain permission to have a high-level security risk assessment of the enterprise by an outside vendor. So sometimes you have to bring in an outside contractor to prove your point. They did confirm the security concerns I had. And as part of that assessment, we also eventually got a proof of concept from Medigate, which were immediately the technical acumen and the ability of that staff and their responsiveness were able to land Medigate as one of our vendors. And something I also want to mention is, you know, this is a brave new world. This is new IoT. This is an exploding area of IT. Medigate has been able to catch up with them. I am continually surprised about the number of updates, changes, and improvements of the actual tool and capabilities that are available to us. It sounds like a horrible plug for this vendor, but it's very true. We've been very happy working with this vendor, and they seem to be able to catch the wave and ride it. So it's we anticipate using them for a long time.
I would just add, Karen, and by the way, I appreciate the shameless plug, but I think something that's notable here, and I speak with 30 years experience in healthcare, mostly supply chain, by the way, that Medigate's dedication to the healthcare vertical, meaning no competing development or service agendas, is essential and meaningful. To your point, talking about staying caught up, I mean, the heavy lift here is being able to write parsers for all of those unique and undocumented protocols that are typical of clinical environments. But we're not trying to figure out how to develop a feature and abstract its benefits to healthcare. Everything that is done is specific to the acute care subvertical. Yeah, we're highly focused. The landscape is shifting rapidly. To your point about the number of the amount of spend, the investment going in, I did some research here recently for a different talk where I saw that they're forecasting 19% compounded annual growth rate on just IOMT. Largely blaming it, by the way, on how COVID pushed forward telehealth by more than a decade. So you're looking at spending of roughly $21 billion this year on medical devices, going to roughly $72 billion by 2025. And all I'll say is that's a lot to keep up with, to your point. But more importantly, that is evidence of a shift or revolution in care. And so, again, I think in terms of being on top of this capability, maintaining an accurate inventory, securing that inventory, common sense, by the way, which is where all the regulatory authorities are pushing right now. Passive network-based data capture is essential. I don't know how you keep up otherwise.
Yeah, and from my standpoint as a security analyst, I've been doing security analysis for 22 years, and I can tell you that I started out my career securing data and securing systems and then securing networks. Well, now it's securing people. If we have class 2 and then future class 3 medical devices, we have to think about the implication for people. So this is critical work.
Yep. Next question.
Great. Our next question is, if you were to prioritize the integrations that you plan to pursue, how would you rank them? CMMS, ServiceNow, Splunk, NAC, segmentation, etc. It seems overwhelming. How have you decided where to start?
Well, I think we mentioned that we're going to start with inventory, which is the base ground for everything, and that probably CMMS would be our first planned integration that we can do. However, depending on when the time frame is for that actual cutover, I'm seriously pushing for now the Splunk integration so that we can respond to any alerts set up and ServiceNow probably coming last, because Medigate does fill that gap for inter-team communications in the meantime. That's my answer. I don't know if others have, Rosalind has another input from that.
Yeah, no, I agree. Inventory is our very first thing that we need to get done. And the CMMS is what we're looking at right now. Inventory is our number one.
Karen and Roz, do you, I touched on it briefly. I'm just curious. It is, and I think for the audience's benefit, you should know that a big part of Medigate's development focus going forward is around being able to look at utilization data that we're capturing as an expression of demand. And therefore, as an expression of demand and sitting on an inventory that expresses capacity, for example, trying to close that gap and find ways to drive ROI, essentially turn asset management and cybersecurity practice, risk reduction practice, into an operational improvement that has meaningful ROI associated with it. I'm just curious from your perspectives and looking at the information, Karen and Roz, have you seen things in terms of, you mentioned that you look at fleets, Karen, where your utilization is an eye opener relative to,
yes,
you know, perhaps where you thought it might have been?
Yeah, I think one of the things I also like about Medigate is they have a reporting tool. And if you click up on the right, you hit the report, it's really easy. It's kind of like reporting for dummies. I like it because it's so quick and easy and I can just check boxes, right? So if I go into the utilization devices, I can do a certain type of device utilization. I can do a certain vendor utilization or a device itself. And it has nice little maps about what percent utilization on the average, what percent utilization by day. I mean, it's really incredible. It's very simple, but you can drill down and it's very easy to look at. There's not a lot of hoo-ha and frills unless you want it, but I find it very useful. And so this type of information we're not yet using, but now that I have the reports, sending them over to purchasing and contracts, I think is something that will probably spread the use of this tool farther, or further, I should say. So yeah, that's an important piece. It's all about money, right? And you know, as far as keeping a program going, and this is a good way to earn its worth, or whatever the saying is.
Yeah, well, as so much of what we talked about, the three of us, early stage around educating management, if you want to catch management's attention, associating an ROI with an operational improvement, you know, CapEx gets everybody's attention, but the operational savings in terms of enhancements to existing workflows, if not elimination of outdated routines altogether based on the capability gained.
Right.
Documenting that value as part of your business case to management is something that we're very much engaged in now with our clients. It just makes sense. I was curious as to how far down that road you were running, and have you had feedback from supply chain and procurement folk?
Yes, I have provided some of those reports where you pull up the report and say, here is, for example, what the utilization is. I send it to purchasing, but then the next step is to get the clinical team or management involved as well. So as they're making decisions for planned purchases, et cetera, you know, it takes multiple hands here, but if you have a drawing and if you have a clean report, that's where we are right now. Discussion is happening now. That's how it all starts.
Okay, any more questions, Tech Nation?
We do. Our next question is, most patches are still deployed physically instead of remotely. How are you tracking the time spent on patch management in your CMMS?
Hi. We actually aren't tracking time for patching in our CMMS because it's Web2Me. We do actually, we track the technician's time, but we don't, there's, that's about as far as that goes. That's what part of the new CMMS is going to help us do, is track that kind of stuff. For biomedical devices, most of our patching is still done by hand. Hopefully someday we'll get more into an automated way of doing it, but right now we're still doing it by hand. Whatever we can do,
right, and the only way that you can really, sorry to cut you off, the only way that you can get the resources to do it is to be able to show what you have in a clean report, and that really isn't easy to do, to identify which systems have outdated firmware or behind a version or haven't been patched. And so I've used that to raise the question about, okay, this is the percent of our devices that are behind patching. How do we get the resources going? And how do we automate this?
Exactly.
Karen, do you know, are you using a vulnerability management platform like a Tenable or a Rapid7?
Yes, we are. We are using that, Rapid7. We also, we are using this. We're also looking at employing traps for malware detection on some of these devices, and we're testing them. We have several that have this, that are using this functionality now.
Yeah, one of that's got another integration area to explore. One of the simple use cases, naturally, there isn't going to be any automated patching going on with medical devices, but for more general IoT, some OT, a real simple bit of insight that Medigate is able to provide through integration with VM is share with the VM platform the status of the device, whether it's just connected or actually in use. A simple distinction there that has implications, to say the least, on any sort of thoughts around trying to drive towards more automated patching, which is certainly available outside of the IOMT realm.
Right. Hopefully some year, some century, we might have some standardization on some of those things that would make them easier. Who knows what the future holds?
Next question.
Actually, we are done for now. Thank you, Thomas, Karen, and Rosalind, for a great presentation. As a reminder to our audience, any questions that were not answered will be sent to our panelists to address offline. I'd like to encourage everyone to visit today's sponsor to learn more about the products they provide to our industry. Visit medigate.io. A quick reminder, you can obtain your CE certificate by completing the post-webinar survey. The survey will be emailed 1 hour after the completion of today's webinar. You must complete the survey to receive your 1 CE credit from the ACI, and you will be able to download the certificate directly from your computer once the survey is submitted. If you have questions, you can reach us at webinar@mdpublishing.com. We will be back next week with another webinar. Visit webinarwednesday.live for more details and complimentary registration.